Welcome to the Pioneer Sideline for another week of fun and excitement. All the Pioneer sports were in action this week, and we had our reporters everywhere to get the best coverage. Our reporters will also be joining me later to talk about the hot topics and national news. So are you ready to join me as we head on down to the Pioneer Sideline? For joining me on the Pioneer Sideline. I'm your host, Kyle Anthony. We'll be starting off talking about men's soccer, who is looking to find a scoring touch. So I'm joined by Charlotta Gurnis, who will tell us if they were able to find that touch.
The Point Park men's soccer team had a competitive week as they faced the Golden Bears and the Cincinnati Christian. The Pioneers began their home game their weekend on home turf Wednesday as they faced against the Golden Bears of West University Technology. The teams have gotten to know each other quite well, as the Pioneers were the only team to defeat the Golden Bears last season. The big question this game was, would Pioneer goaltender Zach Borzovo help lead the team to victory, as he previously done? The game began on an aggressive note and remained scoreless all the way to halftime, but the Golden Bears would claim the win with two back-to-back goals from Sam Lauten and Jose Zegarra. The Pioneers did put up a good fight with 7 out of their 11 shots coming in the second half. The team began the weekend by traveling to Ohio to face the Cincinnati Christian Eagles. Both teams were coming off a loss and hoping to change their momentum. The Pioneers would strike first with a goal by Paul Carr less than 30 minutes into the game. 21 seconds later, Dominic Canelo would give Point Park a 2-goal lead. However, moments later, the Eagles would cut the lead in half. The Pioneers ended up victorious with a score of 4-1, as Alan Ramos and Josh Williams both added goals. Goaltender Zach Borzovo would end the game with 11 saves. The Point Park Pioneers will play next October 8th at 6 p.m. at Washington Adventist.
Now, Charlotta, how was the team able to score their goals?
They were able to score their goals, Kyle, by playing with each other. There was a lot of assists that game, so if they continue to play with each other and just use each other to break off the defense and shoot, then it'll happen.
Do you think the scoring will continue?
I think it will, as long as they continue to getting more and more shots. Last game they had 20 shots, which was a high this season. So if they continue that pattern, they will.
Thanks, Charlotta. The women's soccer team looks to continue their winning ways and their success this season. So for the Inside Scoop 1 team, I'm joined by Cy Banks, who will tell us what we need to know.
Thank you, Kyle. The weather might be a little bitter this cold, time, a little rainy, making us all just want to stay indoors and try to warm up. There was one team that didn't need that warming up, and you can guess it, the women's soccer team, because they were on fire. Point Park women's soccer team lighted it up on the field this past weekend as they played to beat Brishka 7-0 in the KIAC matchup Wednesday at Highmark Stadium. Not one, not two, not three, oh forget it. There was 5 different players that scored the game. The girls played like they had no fear, and they were a freight train ready to break through and attack like there is a bulldozer. Anything in their way, they were making a goal. Didn't matter. They are now 5-3-1-2-0 in the KIAC. Point Park led 3-0 at the half, and the seniors were like, let's have fun. Allison put up the great offensive attack with 2 goals and 2 assists. Senior Louise was right behind her, scoring 2 goals, and with the sophomore Aubrey, had a goal and an assist. Louise lit it up early for the girls as she had an assist from Noelle. Audrey scored an across kick to Allison to make it 2-0. No, she wasn't done because she fed another nice pass to sophomore Katie to put the girls ahead to 3-0. Louise scored again, and in the second half to start it up to make the girls have 4-0. And Aubrey made a beautiful pass to Joyce, Allison Joyce, who then scored to make it 5-0. Their opponents could not ruffle their feathers at that point. Point Park just kept going on fire, just like Allison blowing it up as she made an unassist goal to put the girls at 6-0. Sophomore Anna was like, wait, hold up, let me finish it off. And bam, did an unassisted goal on a free kick from 30 yards back. Point Park senior keeper Erica is now in her third shutout for the season, facing only 4 shots at the goal. That's how much destruction we put on them, that they couldn't even come to the goalie. Goalkeeper Jessica from Briska had got burnt so bad that they had to take her off of the oven. But the oven was still heating up, so they put in their sub, Marley, came in. That just didn't work for them because obviously we just put 2 goals on her also for their goalkeeper. Keeping our undefeated record, they didn't want to let up and prove that in the KIAC matchup, they're going to continue it up with the Cincinnati Christian University, and senior Beth ended up scoring both goals in that game. Now they're at the 6-3-1 and 3-0 in the KIAC, placing the team not just undefeated, but also first in their division. Beth was showed us that Beth was showing us American people how to play English football and scored an unassist goal to the first and the second half of the game. As I told you before, the girls know that no matter who they are playing, it's go time. They showed these past games, we're not here just to play around. We're here to take over the division, and anyone in their path, one of their participants of the summer, let's go, let's try to take it out. But if you want some heart chanting, cheering, and action-packed game, come out this Thursday, and the Pioneer hosts the Georgetown Kentucky College this Thursday, which now brings their house to Let's Go.
Now, how can this team continue to get better?
At this point, as I've said in the past, it's go time. They just have to keep pushing, and that's what you've seen on the field. The seniors are pulling it together and really trying to show the younger girls, we want this. We are striving for it. We can taste it. So what's stopping us? Only us.
Now, who's the MVP so far of this team?
Actually, Erica Rooney and Allison Joyce were named the Players of the Women of the Week for the defense and offense for September 28th to October 1st, which was awesome. October 7th, which was awesome to hear that our girls pulled it out.
Thanks, Sai. The volleyball team had a big weekend in conference play last week. Mike Chirk joins us to talk about that, and if you were able to increase their winning streak. Then Alex Martage gets here to tell us about rugby and how they're doing so far.
Start your morning with city news.
Start your morning with campus news.
Start your morning with political coverage.
Start your morning with fun.
Start your morning with us, only on Daybreak.
Did you know that Point Park has a cheerleading squad? Don't stop. Don't get it confused. Not only do our cheerleaders represent Point Park at regional and national competitions, but they also promote spirit and awareness of every sports team on campus. Come to any men's or women's varsity basketball game at home to watch the cheerleaders perform at halftime and cheer from the sidelines from the first jump ball to the final buzzer. Sports not your thing? You can catch the cheer team lead the crowd at the fall and spring pep rallies as well, or at several competitions around Pittsburgh each year. So what are you waiting for? Show the Point Park cheerleaders the support they show you.
We know you're wondering what the A-list celebrities are up to.
Well, here at Entertainment on Point, we're wondering too.
Have you heard about James Franco and Seth Rogen's new movie?
No, but have you heard Beyonce's new single?
Did you see what she was wearing on that red carpet?
Mm-mm, honey, that was not cute.
Did you see what happened on Scandal this week?
No, I was too busy keeping up with the Kardashians. No matter what your guilty pleasure is, we've got you covered.
Entertainment on point. Get into the point of pop culture.
Yeah!
The volleyball team is coming off a long layoff, so tell us if they were able to get the rust off. I'm joined by Mike Turk, who has the answer.
You can call the Point Park Pioneers girls volleyball team butter because they are on a roll. Ba-dun-dun. They played a doubleheader at home this past Friday and were able to come out victorious in both matches. They first took on KIAC opponent Ohio Christian Trailblazers. It was the Pioneers' first match in 12 days, so they came out looking a little rusty, and then they dropped the first set by a score of 25-17. The Pioneers would then settle in and take command of the next three sets by dominating scores of 25-11, 25-13, and 25-14. Later that same day, the Pioneers faced off against a struggling KIAC opponent, a 2-13 Midway Kentucky University team. The Pioneers were able to sweep the Eagles and pick up their sixth consecutive win. On her 22nd birthday, junior right side hitter Megan Branchick was causing issue for the defenses all day. Neither team had an answer for her as she hit a whopping 447% in the matches. Ironically, she recorded 22 kills on her 22nd birthday, which led the team for the entire day. If we take a look at the KIAC standings, the Pioneers are ranked number 3 right now behind a very impressive 21-2 IU Kokomo team and a 13-8 Asbury team. The 9-11 Point Park team will head to the Sunshine State this week and play four non-KIAC opponents. They play their first match on October 7th against a 15-3 St. Thomas, Florida. Then on October 10th, they play three matches against Trinity Florida College, Kaiser Florida, and Florida College. It will be a tough road ahead for the Pioneers as they take on multiple teams with records above 500. The Pioneers return home to play on Tuesday, October 13th, to square off against KIAC opponent West Virginia Tech University, who currently ranks second to last in the KIAC standings.
Now, what were you looking for from this team after they had such a long layoff?
Well, I expected to see a lot of rust, and I was there at that game, and we did see a lot of rust. They had a lot of unforced hitting errors and just a lot of errors in the back row with passing.
Now, this team seems to have a tendency to play down to some of their weaker opponents. Why do you think that is?
I don't feel like they go in with the mindset every game that you have to treat every game like it's your last. They got to play tough against every team, no matter if the record's 2-13 or 13-2.
Thanks, Mike. The Point Park rugby team looks to continue to play better in their games this week. So I'm joined by Alex Martich, who would tell us if their play got any better.
Thanks, Kyle. The rugby team was back in action this past Saturday as they took on an undefeated Robert Morris Colonials team. The Pioneers were 1-2 entering the match, losing two straight since their win to open the season versus Fairmont. The Pioneers were led by captains Jacob Como and Colby Barrett as the team went into the half only down 24-12. Unfortunately, though, the Colonials pulled away in the second half due in large part to the fact captain Colby Barrett, as well as Andrew Stojan, Joel Marslin, and Dan Helbling all were forced to leave the game in the second half due to injury. This was a tough loss for the Pioneers, but one that also gave them a lot of different things that they will be able to work on during practice. Despite the outcome of the game Saturday, the future of the team looks very bright. The game ball was awarded to freshman Elliot Carr, who made his first start for the team. It is a rarity in the game of rugby to see a freshman get playing time, let alone play a full 80 minutes. The Pioneers will face off next against a very well-coached Grove City team, which has given them trouble in the past, but similarly have had a terribly difficult time dealing with the injuries that they suffered in their match against Robert Morris. Following this match versus Grove City, the team will have two regular season games remaining, as they will face off at home versus Gannon and finish it all off with the biggest game of the season against rival Carnegie Mellon.
Now, Alex, how much have injuries hurt this team?
Well, injuries have played a huge part in their season, unfortunately, and it's something that happens in all sports, and similarly, it doesn't allow the team to gain a tempo. Whenever you are constantly having to switch in and switch out different players, it really disrupts the team's tempo and ultimately leads to losses.
Now, what does the team need to do to get to that next level?
Well, to get to the next level, I think, unfortunately, they first have to come to grasps with the fact that much of the team is injured, and therefore they're going to have to prep the people that are going to be coming in for those injured players and really try to focus with those second string players and make sure that they are ready to go in what for some of them will be their first action of this season.
The men's and women's golf team are entering the home stretch of their fall season. Phil Popoor will tell us how they did in the conference preview. Then Paul Daniels shows us two of the newest inductees into the Point Park Athletic Hall of Fame.
Here at the Pioneers sideline, we get freshmen involved as quickly as possible so they get the real-world experience on air and behind the scenes to set themselves apart in internships and potential jobs. Blaine, where is that video? I needed it in Key Pro like yesterday.
All right, I got you, Chris, but I got a quick question for you guys.
What do you mean a question? Like, it's always a question. It's always a... What? Where is he? Blaine! Freshman, you can't find any good ones anymore.
Do you ever wanted to be behind the mic and have the world listening to your show on campus? Well, it's just as simple as joining WPPJ, Point Park's student-run radio station, located on the second floor of Lawrence Hall, right next to the dining services. Listeners can tune in using Point Park's website or through the TuneIn app by searching WPPJ. WPPJ welcomes any new DJs that want to get involved, so be heard. Do you have what it takes?
The golf team looks to get in as many rounds as they can before golf gets shut down to the spring season. So our resident golf reporter, Phil Popoor, will join me to talk about the team.
Thanks, Kyle. Both the Point Park men's and women's golf teams were in action this past weekend. Both squads participated in the Kentucky Intercollegiate Athletic Conference fall preview. We'll start with the men's side. All nine KIAC golf teams were at this event, so it was an early opportunity for the Pioneers to send a message to the rest of the conference. Now, the Pioneers are the reigning KIAC champions, but only one golfer from that team remains on the team this year, so the team is definitely looking to reestablish itself. This was a solid effort from the Pioneers as the team finished day one in fourth place, within 14 strokes of first place Asbury. Realizing the importance of this tournament, senior Kevin Lautensizer led the Pioneers' final round charge. The team cut down 14 strokes from the previous day to gain ground on Asbury, but it just wasn't enough. Asbury shot a final round score of 310 to win the tournament by 9 strokes over West Virginia Tech. The Pioneers did manage to break into the top 3 with an overall score of 632. This young team still has a lot to learn, and that's something head coach Gage Bubon stressed when he said the only way to get experience is through competition, and that the team finished right where it belongs. Now for the women's team, 6 of the 7 KIAC squads, were at this tournament. Now this is a Pioneer team that has improved week in and week out, so the team expected a solid finish at the event. Compared to previous weeks, the team faltered. After day one, the Pioneers were 52 strokes behind leader Asbury after carding a total score of 392. The team improved by 8 strokes on the final day, but it was not enough as Brescia played extremely well down the stretch to take first place from Asbury by 5 strokes. This was the final tournament of the fall for the women's team, but the men will have one more opportunity at the Carnegie Mellon Tournament October 15th.
Playing back-to-back good rounds.
Really, Kyle, it's just all about confidence and momentum. One thing that a lot of golfers do is they get in their heads, especially when they have a good round. They want to immediately get back out there. They want to try and repeat that. And that kind of, it sometimes leads golfers to overthink, and that's the worst thing you can do in golf. You want to be prepared. So you definitely want to prepare going into round two, but you don't want to overthink it, thinking, okay, I have to match this, I have to do better here, because that's when you start to make mistakes, and then that's just when the mistakes compound and leads to a worse round.
Now, Phil, I know a lot of golfers don't go out in the bad weather, but there are some diehard people that do. How do you prepare yourself to go out there when you really have no idea if it's going to rain the whole time you're out there or not?
Well, really, if you're put in a situation where you're going out to golf and you're not sure of what the weather is, if maybe it's a last-second decision to go out and play around, you really just always want to make sure that you have your bag set. You want to have extra towels. You want to have a golf umbrella. You want to maybe have extra gloves. It's really just about constantly being prepared. And then other than that, it's just kind of the same thing. You just have to stay in your head. You have to play your game. You just can't let the weather kind of affect your decisions. You just have to play smart. Just be confident. You just really don't want to let the weather get you down. And like I said, the last couple of weeks, it's really just about focusing on hitting right at the base of the ball. And it's just being prepared. That's really the most important thing you can do in terms of playing in the rain.
Thanks, Phil. Every year, the Point Park Athletics Department chooses two former student-athletes to be inducted in the Athletics Hall of Fame. Last week, two new Point Park alumni were inducted. Pioneer sideline reporter Paul Daniels has more from Lawrence Hall.
I'm just outside the Lawrence Hall lobby where the annual Point Park Athletics Hall of Fame induction is about to get started and where plenty of alums can reminisce about their past as seen here. When Randy Smith took the court in 1989, he never thought he'd make it here 16 years later. But now, he's in the Point Park Hall of Fame.
I actually was surprised, to be honest with you, when I got the call. And when they told me, it was funny because my wife went here as well. She said, "You'll probably get in." I didn't think I would. So I'm very glad to be in the Hall of Fame.
Joining Randy in the honor is legendary volleyball player Rachel Roddy. Starting in 2007, number 21 helped bring the volleyball program to where it is today.
I never considered whenever I was here as a player, so definitely a big accomplishment to kind of bring everything like full circle, I would say.
Randy and Rachel also excelled in the classroom. Roddy was an NAIA scholar athlete with a 3.92 GPA, and Smith was an academic All-American candidate. Randy and Rachel's family and friends joined in the honor, which culminated with a standing ovation for their accomplishments. And it was another successful Hall of Fame induction here at Point Park University, and there will be many more to come in the future. Reporting for Point News, I'm Paul Daniels.
Thanks, Paul. Paul is going to join us after the break, along with Alec Martage and Blaine King, to discuss national sports headlines in another round of the Pioneer Reporters.
Has a purpose, has a dream to have their voices heard, no matter where they come from, no matter where they go. As an American, it is their right to have freedom of speech. I have a dream that one day this message will speak louder than words, that even the quietest voice will not go unnoticed. That is my dream. What is yours? For more information, visit www.freedomofspeechpsa.org.
Welcome back to the sideline. It's time for another round of the Pioneer Reporters. I'm joined by Alex Martage, Blaine King, and Paul Daniels. Guys, the first topic we're going to talk about is Joe Philbin being fired. Do you agree with the decision and why?
Well, it's always tough to say. We hit the quarter mark of the season so far, and they're 1-3. This team has had high expectations going in. They signed a lot of players in free agency, and they haven't performed. But it's tough to say whether that was a good decision or not, because a team can collapse after a head coach is fired.
You know, personally, I think they pulled the trigger a little bit too fast. I think that it's a little bit unfair, only four games into the season, to judge them based on that. I mean, there are still 0-4 teams. I believe the Detroit Lions are still 0-4, and they still have their coach. Yeah, I think it was a little bit unfair, but at the same time, I think it probably would have happened eventually.
I think it was fair. I never like to see a coach get fired in the middle of the season, but it had to happen. The Dolphins are underperforming. And they've been underperforming for years to come, for the past few years, actually. And Joe Philbin was brought in to actually kind of change that culture. And we all thought he was going to be fired last year and 2 years ago. So it was kind of time for that relationship to end.
Yeah, I agree with your thoughts, Blaine. I think there was just so much turmoil there, and he just undersucceeded with all the money that team spent. He had to be fired. Now we're going to go another coach in firing. We're going to go to Matt Williams, who was the Nationals manager, who got fired. I disagree with him being fired. I think it was the personnel decisions that sunk that team. Right. I don't know what you guys think.
Well, this was another team that disappointed heavily in the regular season. This was a team that many experts picked to win the World Series, and they didn't even make the playoffs. One of the questionable decisions was bringing Papelbon onto the team when they had already an established closer in Drew Storen. And I think the team just didn't gel chemistry-wise, and that pretty much cost them the season.
You know, I think any time that you have a player that's the caliber of Bryce Harper, it's pretty difficult to, you know, to perform the way overall the team they did. And I think personally that it was probably the best decision.
I actually don't think it was the best decision. This guy, Matt Williams, was coming off of a Manager of the Year last year, and the Nationals had very, very high hopes. Many people picked them to win the World Series this year, and I have to think it's bringing in Papelbon. That was definitely an issue. He kind of messed the chemistry of the team up, and I mean, this team was on its way to implosion anyway, but I don't agree with the firing, and sadly, I think the Nationals may struggle for years to come now again.
Now, guys, we're going to go to college football. Is Leonard Fournette running away with the Heisman, or are we just overhyping him?
You can't be overhyping this guy. I looked at his stats earlier today, and he has almost 900 yards rushing in less than 100 attempts with 11 touchdowns. He is just pounding the league. And he's definitely the front runner. I'd say a close second right now is Nick Chubb. He's also having a really good season. But Leonard Fournette is definitely the front runner.
All right, Alex, I know you have a strong opinion on this topic.
Well, currently I would have to actually go with Leonard Fournette for Heisman. The stats do not lie. He has had an unbelievable season thus far. But I think, you know, luckily for us, there is still a lot of college football to be played. And I would agree, though, with your current assessment that it would probably be Leonard Fournette at number one, Nick Chubb at number two. But you cannot forget about the crop top, about Ezekiel Elliott. He ran for over 650 yards in the last three games of last season and 8 touchdowns. And I think, considering he had 265 yards in 3 TDs.
I'm just saying.
We'll
go to the guy nodding his head next. Let's take it
yeah,
up,
Yeah, I
BK.
Think Leonard Fournette is actually running away with the Heisman right now. I actually think Zeke Elliott is too. I truthfully think so. I kind of think he's carrying the Ohio State team right now. If they make it to the national championship game or even the Final Four, it's going to be a big part of him, but I think Leonard Fournette is actually running away with this, and I kind of don't see anybody else taking it except for Zeke Elliott.
All right. I actually think Fournette's running away with it, but I think he's going to have the Darren McFadden problem, and because he's carrying his team so much, he's going to end up losing because their team is. All right, we're going to go to our final topic. Do you guys agree with Clay Matthews mocking Colin Kaepernick? BK, you get to start us off this time, buddy.
You know, he said, and he also said, you're no Russell Wilson, and Cap has been struggling, and the 49ers aren't the same team at all. Now, I think it's mainly because Jim Harbaugh's not there, but I actually have no problem with it at all.
I would agree. I think that Colin Kaepernick has a little bit of RG3 syndrome. He started off very hot in the league, since has definitely cooled off, and definitely he feels he should be getting more respect, but he needs to earn it before he gets that.
I think I agree with these two as well. I think it's fair game. It's time to pull up your big boy pants, Kaepernick, because this is the National
Fighting
Football
words.
League.
Ever since he threw that interception in Seattle.
All right, I actually like Cam Matthews. I agree with what he did, but let's not forget, Colin Kaepernick did torch him twice in two big playoff games and drop like almost 300 yards of rushing.
But Clay
right.
has the Super Bowl.
All right, Blaine. Well, that does it for this week on the sideline. Make sure to check out our YouTube channel for more bonus footage, because we're going to be doing some stuff with the Pirates during the playoffs. So join me next week at the same Pioneer channel, the same Pioneer time, and of course, the same Pioneer sideline.